I welcome you on behalf of the University of South Australia and the Hawke Centre. My name is Elizabeth Ho. I'm the director of the Hawke Centre, and we have an important forum, the Murray-Darling Basin Plan, from the past into the future. I begin by paying our profound respects to the Kaurna people. We meet in the place of the red kangaroo. We've had the help of elders of the Kaurna people in creating the Hawke Centre's gallery. And we thank them and recognise their special connection to country and the opportunity to meet here tonight. Thank you. We offer a year-long program at the Hawke Centre to encourage attendees, as we put it, to think, connect, and act. And act in spheres where social responsibility is demanded. We work with government, NGOs, charitable groups, and many community organisations to achieve this. Our international patron is Nelson Mandela. Our favourite quote, "Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world." And we are deeply committed here to fostering understanding about critical issues. And tonight we certainly have a very critical matter to discuss in the Murray-Darling Basin Plan. We encourage you to do these things in terms of action. You can feedback and make comment about the matters covered tonight by going to the above website. We are encouraging you to post stories about the drought and even photos that help tell the story. In addition, you can post comments on the draft basin plan, and you can ask questions. So this is the place where you can continue to engage. Secondly, and this gets back to our education theme, if friends and colleagues cannot make it tonight, they can still access this session. The session podcast will be available shortly on the Hawke Centre website. We would be grateful if you could switch all phones to silent, given that we are recording tonight's proceedings. I note also our question policy. The chair requests questions, not long statements. That way, we are more democratic. We give others the chance to ask their question. So I hope as many of you as possible can participate in the question time. There are audience members from every profession here tonight, and I thank you very much for your interest. But I especially welcome all community members who seek to protect the Murray in so many ways. You are to be congratulated for your commitment to our state and our river. I thank also the following people for their attendance. Our distinguished panel members, who will be introduced more fully by our chair, but noting in particular the Premier, the Honourable Jay Weatherill, and Mr. Mitch Williams, MP and Deputy Leader of the Opposition, and Shadow Minister for Water Security and the River, Murray, representing the Leader of the Opposition, Ms. Isabel Redmond. Other Members of Parliament, Jeff Brock, Member for Frome, and Tim Whetstone, Member for Chaffey. Senior Representative of the University of South Australia, Professor Palalawalia, Pro Vice Chancellor. And special guests, someone that we greatly admire, Barbara Hardy, well known for her active dedication to conservation and the namesake of our Barbara Hardy Institute at the University of South Australia. The Honourable Justice Thomas Gray of the Supreme Court of South Australia, Alan Holmes, the Chief Executive of the Department for Environment and Natural Resources, Scott Ashby, Chief Executive, Department for Water, and Rob Fowler, President of the Conservation Council of South Australia. It now gives me great pleasure to hand over proceedings to our chair tonight, Professor Chris Daniels. Chris is a dynamo He is the director of the Barbara Hardy Institute at the University of South Australia. He is an ecology specialist. He is an author, a broadcaster, but in particular in relation to tonight, he's well known for his commitment to citizen science. So without further ado, Chris will take us through the proceedings, and I hope you have a very interesting and informative evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Elizabeth. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Bob Hawke Prime Ministerial Centre Forum. We called it the Murray-Darling Basin Plan, From the Past to the Future. This is a panel session to inform and engage all of the South Australian community. As you know, my name is Chris Daniels. I'm the director of the Barbara Hardy Institute for Sustainability and also the presiding member of the Adelaide Mount Lofty NRM Board. To paint some background, the past drought has painted a very clear picture of the fragility of the Murray-Darling Basin and the need for a national approach to managing the basin based on sound science. Being at the end of the basin, South Australia suffers the worst impacts of the overallocation and diversions that occur upstream, and is most deeply aware of the many threats posed by an ailing system. While South Australia may be the state with the most at stake with regard to the plan, it is also the state that has to work the hardest to be heard amongst the larger economies of New South Wales and Victoria, which are driven by the strength of their irrigators. It could also be argued that South Australia is the state that has worked the hardest to manage its water most effectively and is now at the limit of its efficiency capacity. An important reason for the highly political nature of the disputes over the Murray, the Darling, and the associated rivers of the Murray-Darling Basin is that these watercourses represent far more than a water supply. They embody or have embodied at different times the vision of settlement, land ownership, boundary demarcation, agricultural development, transportation, environmental amenity, tourism, nation building, trade, and economic prosperity. The states therefore have concerns with not just the water, but its ownership, flow, storage, control, distribution, and future use. The first intercolonial conference on the management of the River Murray occurred in 1863, but there was little agreement at this and subsequent conferences because of the increasingly entrenched views of New South Wales and Victoria that the rivers belonged to them. One is reminded of the great debate at the Australian Constitutional Convention up to 1898, where Edmund Barton, representing New South Wales, famously said, "What is the difference between taking away some of our water and taking away some of our land?" Alfred Deakin, who was representing Victoria, somewhat pompously said, "Exactly." Kingston, representing South Australia, replied, "But it's not your water." The final compromise was Section 100 of the Constitution, which says the Commonwealth shall, not by any law or regulation of trade or commerce, abridge the right of the state or of the residents therein to the reasonable use of the waters of the rivers for conservation or irrigation. So the Commonwealth effectively walked away and was left to the states to sort it out. New South Wales and Victoria asserted that South Australia had no rights. We've clearly come a long way since those days of our founding fathers, but we still have a long way to go. And it's not all about the politics. Droughts like the 2003 to 2008 event bring the necessity for sufficient environmental flows into stark relief. However, flooding rains also raise important questions about water management. In the last 12 months, we've had two huge rainfall events. This time last year, central Queensland and northern New South Wales extensively flooded, whilst just last week, the region encompassing the headwaters of the Murray and the Murrumbidgee has been inundated. What happens when we get heavy rain after the catchments are full and the river is flowing? Of course, nobody wants to see Renmark or Murray Bridge suffer the same fate as Wagga Wagga. So how do we manage flood risk at the top end of the catchment while still ensuring regular and sufficient flows at the estuarine end and conserving water for the droughts that will inevitably come later? In times of both drought and flooding rains, it is clear that we need a plan that manages water from headwater to estuary for the benefit of everyone and for the environment. The Basin Plan is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to reset the rules of the river in a way that builds resilience and ensures the long-term health of the entire river system. Even within South Australia, there are a range of interests connected to the Basin Plan, but we hold that a general agreement can be reached where diverse interests can find enough common ground to support a united position that gets the best deal for the state. And that's the purpose of this session. This forum brings together a panel of experts representing a range of interests, irrigator, environment and government, to discuss the critical issues surrounding the draft basin plan and to engage the community in the development of a state position on the plan. There are some big questions at play surrounding the draft basin plan, and these include, just to name a few, what are the issues that the state must grapple with and what are the compromises that are worth making? Is the draft basin plan better than no plan? Is accepting a less than optimal starting point in favour of updates over time an acceptable strategy? Will the environmental objectives of the Water Act be met by this plan? Why are we buying up water licences when additional floodwater continues to be held upstream by other states? How much water does the river actually need to remain healthy? Is a reduction of 2,750 gigalitres from the current 2009 baseline diversion limits enough? Alternatively, is giving back more to the environment too stressful for our irrigation-dependent industries? A saving of 1,468 gigalitres per year still needs to be found, but from where? Where will a shortfall of 971 gigalitres from the southern basins come from? What is the expected contribution of South Australia? Should it all come from upstream users? Where will the additional water needs for dealing with the additional increasing demands from mining, climate change and population growth come from? And most crucial of all, what will happen to all South Australians when we return to drought conditions? To help us grapple with these issues, we will first have seven short presentations to set the context for the discussion. Four panel members will speak for 10 minutes each, followed by a 5-minute presentation by our three stakeholder representatives. A bell, this bell, will sound when you have 1 minute remaining, and timing will need to be strictly adhered. That's my warning to the panel members. So I'm going to introduce the panel members first, and then when it comes time to call them up, we'll call them up very briefly. The first of our panel members is Dr. Susan Marsden, a historical consultant and author. She will talk on the historical underpinnings of the Murray-Darling Basin. She'll be followed by Dr. Tony Minns, the director of the Goyder Institute for Water Research, who will talk on the ecology of the Murray-Darling Basin, what are the elements of a healthy river system, and how are these related to the draft basin plan. Then we have the Premier, the Honourable Jay Weatherall, who will talk on building a state position on the basin plan, to be followed by Mr. Mitch Williams, who will also talk on the same topic. Then we have our stakeholders who will address particular issues. We have Diane Bell, Professor Diane Bell from the Conservation Council, who will discuss the Lower Murray. Mr. Ben Hazlett from the South Australian River Communities Group, who is an irrigator. And we have Associate Professor Daryl Rigney from Flinders University, who will take the Narrangeri perspective. After this panel session is completed, we are to have a question and answer session. Now, as chair, it's my prerogative to ask one question of each, which I've divided into two parts. And that question then is is one thing that each panel member wants to see in the plan, and what is one thing that cannot be allowed to go forward? We will write those things up as they come up, and then I will ask you to address questions to the panel. If you can, focus on those things that we want in the plan and we want to see excluded from the plan or removed or not demonstrated. The idea of having these initial questions is to focus your questions so we can build a plan together. These answers will be shown on screen, and any other questions can be delivered and put on the website. So without any further ado, I will invite Dr. Susan Marsden to the microphone.
Thank you, and thank you for inviting me here. History is a river flowing from the past through now till tomorrow, and the River Murray is history. The Murray-Darling Basin has a continuous more than 40,000 year history as the food bowl of the continent. The rivers were also major thoroughfares, and their margins were sites of intensive human settlement well before British occupation of Australia. So the first point to make in this historical overview is that the Murray-Darling is an ancient and a modern cultural landscape. Thank you. It has also, of course, for the same reason, been in contention, probably for thousands of years. And so that history of dispute is a very long history. The first disputes in the written record, of course, were between some of the Aboriginal owners of the Murray waters and lands and the overlanders who were bringing stock to the new province of South Australia in the 1830s. So the River Murray, since Charles Sturt traced its route and gave it a name, which was also in contention because Hume had already named it, in 1830, has been of major importance to South Australia and to South Australians. Sturt's own published account, South Australia was an idea looking for a place to happen, and Sturt's own account actually helped them decide to place it here, near the bottom of the river. The first and largest state government or government colonial government expenditures were in fact directed at the river to expedite river navigation in the 1850s. South Australia had the first irrigation settlement on the Murray by a matter of months at Renmark. And it initiated the system of locks and weirs, with which we're still very familiar. In fact, I visited the bottom end of that system, which was completed in 1940, the Gore Barrages. That was a great federal state project, but it was initiated by South Australia. The first one was at Blanchetown. And since 1944, when the Morgan-Whyalla pipeline was built by the South Australian government, successive pipelines have carried Murray water to most of South Australia's people, as we all know. In fact, more than 90% of us. So there, in brief, are the main reasons the Murray waters are important to South Australia. So in terms of the draft basin plan, the basin communities include most of the population of South Australia. I remember a farmer friend of mine saying he had the Murray flowing past his front door, and he lives on the York Peninsula. The Aboriginal European conflict over Murray waters was resolved by forced negotiation and attrition. The argument then shifted to dispute between the individual British colonies established in Eastern Australia in the exact half century after 1788. So how we should use the River Murray waters and who should use them is not a new topic of debate. How old that debate may come as something of a surprise, the very first intercolonial conference of 1863 in Melbourne was looking at the navigability of Australia's inland rivers. What they decided was that the works required to maintain navigation were the responsibility of the governments who had jurisdiction over the individual rivers. No attempt was made to clarify who could carry out work on rivers such as the Murray, which flowed through more than one colony. So you could argue that the dispute between states over the use of the Murray waters dates from at least 1863. This was well before Federation, of course, and it was, as you would expect, a major topic of discussion in the lead-up to Australian Federation, particularly in the 1880s and 1890s. However, that constitution did not assign that responsibility to the new Commonwealth government, despite the fact that this was a national resource that crossed then three state boundaries and, of course, nowadays actually includes the Australian Capital Territory as well. So should it have been assigned as a national responsibility in the constitution? And there's still time to change the constitution, as we all know. We're all busily doing it a lot. Some attempt at collaboration also, however, dated back to that 1863 conference. They did discuss then a system of locks and weirs, that right back in 1863, but it was another 50 years before an agreement between the Commonwealth, South Australia, New South Wales and Victoria led to the formation of the River Murray Commission in 1915. So I would point out that sometimes these things take a very long time to sort out, to not be too impatient sometimes. The enactment of uniform legislation occurred in 1915, and this was the first major instance of cooperative management of an issue on a federal basis at all in Australian history. So I think that's actually quite an achievement, and I think we've gone on trying to build on that with difficulty. However, on the other hand, it was a federal agreement, not just a national one, and I think that's a very important distinction to make as well. What's also forgotten in that long history is that the Murray Waters debate has resulted not only in frustrating failures and a lot of hot air, but in some remarkable achievements, even making contribution to Federation and the creation of our Australian nation in 1901. Even not only some of the recent improvements in infrastructure, but also, in fact, the locks and weirs, despite the fact that they've created a lot of problems, were also a major achievement of infrastructure. I have prepared another chronology, but I won't read it out here. It's too long to talk about. I think there are probably four main phases. There's the pre-1830s period, which is a very long period, of, I say, at least 40,000 years, where it was an integrated human and natural environment, and that's in fact what we are now trying to re-establish, not necessarily going back to that, but certainly to re-establish this cultural landscape that has natural attributes as well as cultural attributes. Then we had the period, of course, of main focus on river navigation until the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century. And then we had a long period of really struggling to manage the water resources in the face of rising, intensifying use of the river. Industrial, we had soldier settlement schemes, etc., right through the period. And it was really only from the 1980s and the next phase has developed, of finally trying to balance all of those uses with the actual environmental health of the river system itself. However, still in the face of rising consumption. Federation, as I've said, brought redoubled efforts and some slow successes, so we could also divide this 170-year chronology into pre- and post-federal eras. And a number of key collaborative federal agreements have been reached over the past 100 years, including the 1915 agreement I mentioned, the creation of an authority, the COAG Intergovernment Agreement of 1994, and so on, and up to and including a basin plan that hasn't yet been imposed, that is actually a consultative document. How can we therefore strengthen and build out or from those strategies and achievements? And that's certainly something that I would like to ask of the basin plan itself. I won't. One of the things I wanted to say, because I was down at Woodville today working on a history of West Lakes, in fact, another wetlands area, former, and picked up the waterproofing the West public information sheet. But one of the points that I wanted to make about showing this is one of the suggestions in the whole approach to this has been to improve infrastructure. When we did our first heritage study at the Murray-Darling back in the early 1980s, we were struck by the fact that at that point ENWF was undergrounding all the original irrigation channels. We were concerned as heritage advisors that in fact they'd all disappear before we had the chance to preserve any of them, but it has a very long history of changing the infrastructure of the river. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Susan. I'd now invite Dr. Tony Minns to come to the microphone.
Thank you very much, Chris, and ladies and gentlemen. I have been asked to talk about the ecology of the Murray-Darling Basin and what are the elements of a healthy river system and how are these related to the draft basin plan. So essentially, I've been asked in 10 minutes to teach you everything you need to know about hydrology, hydraulics, ecology, river basin management, and basin plans. Here we go. I could, of course, start by listing all the things that we need to know, and I won't spend much really time on this because these presentations are available or will be available to you afterwards, and certainly my presentation with all the notes are available to anyone who wishes to download them. But one of the major issues I'd like to bring up at this stage, apart from all these wonderful statistics about the basin that you all can read there, is a very important thing. As you see there, a map shows this wonderful natural-looking river, but really, this is what the river, certainly the lower Murray, looks like. It is a very, very highly modified and highly managed system. There are lakes, locks, weirs, they've all been mentioned before, dams, and in fact, we control the way the river flows as a human entity rather than as a natural entity. And this is what we have to learn to live with, is how do we want to operate that river to get the best out of it for us. One of the things to also remember, as I said, the things that have changed in the river, you see there, for example, below Lake Victoria, this way, no, yes, that'll work. Around Lake Victoria, below Lake Victoria, you see rows of locks and weirs along the river. The river in that particular area, for example, really has changed. It's just become a series of deeper, slow-moving lakes with relatively horizontal water backed up behind the locks and the weirs. And so the entire ecology of the river as a natural system has changed significantly. Perhaps also very interesting to see are some bits of information. This is taken from studies back in 1988 was this study of how we've actually changed the flows in the river system through this management. For example, if we look at Albury on the Murray River below the Hume Reservoir, we actually see that on the red line that's shown there, which is a modelled, but at least an estimate, of what a natural flow would have looked like in an undeveloped Murray River system, where we see higher flows occurring in the winter months and lower flows occurring during the summer months, as you would all expect. And then the dotted line, which I'm hoping you can see, yes, shows actually, in 1988 at least, what was actually happening. We'd completely changed the entire operation of the river. In fact, making lower flows occur during the winter months, when in fact we have conceived that we don't need as much water in the river, and changing all of that to actually give us higher flows in the summer months when we conceive we need that. But then as we move downstream, for example down here to Yarrawonga Weir, we see then already by the time we get to just downstream of Yarrawonga Weir, where there are a lot of offtakes for irrigation and other purposes, in fact the total volume of water coming down the river has been severely depleted. And in fact, you'll see there's almost no seasonal variation whatsoever anymore. We've just taken everything we need from the river. And it's not until we get perhaps down to an area around Euston where we actually see a slight return to a natural sort of flow, where we actually now have higher flows in winter, lower flows in summer, but still severely reduced compared to natural situations. Whoops. So what sort of river system are we talking about? We know we have a very ecologically extremely diverse river basin. From the alpine systems up into the Great Dividing Range, ephemeral rivers, that is rivers which are dry sometimes, wet some other years. We have forests and the large river stretches that you all recognize from your holidays on the river. The wetlands, the oxbow lakes, the billabongs, however you wish to call them, extremely valuable ecosystems for the biota and the creatures around the river. The lakes, the lower lakes, Lake Alexandrina, Lake Albert, and of course down to the Murray mouth, where we also must recognize that as an ecological system, these ecosystems have been recognized as ecological systems of extreme importance and recognized in such conventions as the Ramsar conventions, in which we have defined for ourselves, for example, in the Coorong and lower lakes, that that is an ecosystem of international importance, and we have actually said that the lower lakes, that is Lake Alexandrina and Lake Albert, must remain as freshwater lakes in perpetuity, that the Coorong is an estuary and it has a salinity gradient so that it's slightly saline in the northern parts of the Coorong and much more saline as we get to the south in the Coorong, and we have also said the Murray mouth must be open. So what are the issues in South Australia? I won't spend much time here, it's already been mentioned. We know, of course, we've talked about the whole river system, but what's really important to South Australia? Well, of course, it's the tourism, the agriculture, viticulture, the wetlands and the ecosystems that we also wish to maintain for our future generations, for our own enjoyment, and for the health of the river, and of course, the water supply. Of course, not only to the metropolitan area, but as was pointed out, to actually a great many communities in the state. So what is it that we are confronted with? What are the issues really that we need to consider if we're going to try and manage this river? Well, one of the things that we are confronted with is, and I pointed out already, we have a severe decrease in the amount of water coming down the river, and that was most clearly demonstrated during the, or at the end of, or actually during the last drought, when the Murray mouth actually closed off. There just wasn't enough water to push that sand out of the way. There wasn't enough water to actually flow into the ocean. The river essentially stopped flowing. There just wasn't enough water. Just to, as an indicator of that, just again, just some of the facts and figures backing that up. Some a study here from 2002, which actually shows what the reductions in those flows are throughout the basin. And it's interesting, down there at the Murray mouth, we actually now only have about 27%, that's about a quarter, of the original natural flows coming down to the mouth of the river. What are the other issues, though, that come up because of this lack of water? We saw during the drought aspects of riverbank collapse, that is, there is less water in the river, the banks collapse, causing immense problems with economic activities, damage to infrastructure. As the river gets lower, it moves slower, the temperatures in the water heat up, we get algal blooms. As the water dries out, the soils become more saline, acid in the soils come to the surface, killing off the life on the top of the soils. We are seeing through invasive species, fish, as in the European carp, taking over and pushing out our natural and indigenous fish species. And another term you will have heard or perhaps read about in the paper quite a lot, a term which we call blackwater events. Here's a picture actually which shows the Darling flowing into the Murray. If you look very carefully, you can see the muddy waters of the Darling coming down into what looks like black water from the Murray. And as you follow that a little bit further downstream, you can actually see where the two streams, side by side, take quite a long time to mix into each other. A blackwater event is actually a natural event, funnily enough, but it's a very severe environmental event in as much as usually after long periods of dry conditions, followed by a flood, those floodwaters come out onto the floodplains, pick up a lot of organic matter, dead leaves, dead branches, wash them into the river, where problems occur in the river where that organic material absorbs or uses all the oxygen in the river, causing this blackened colour of the river, and that black water event moves on downstream, causing problems for the downstream recipients of that water, South Australia. Black water is in fact not suitable for drinking, for irrigating, for any of those purposes, and we have to learn to deal with those events. So what have we actually been doing to the river, even before the plan came out? We have, even during the drought, been trying to water the system to keep the valuable ecosystems that we have wet or wetted at times when we feel that that's necessary. And we are trying to emulate or try to reproduce the fact that a real system, a real natural system, needs to flood regularly. We've constructed all sorts of infrastructure to overcome the problems that we have created in the river ourselves. So the fact that we've built weirs and locks along the river has actually blocked the movement of fish up the river. And we've built fish ladders to try and get those fish up and down the river. And the problems with salt, we pointed out before, we have built salt interception schemes, and we are introducing more efficient irrigation techniques to try and stop that from happening further. Now, what does that actually mean in the terms of a basin plan? Is that a plan we've been told we need to develop, which contains management plans for all of the catchments in the Murray-Darling Basin. It must address this issue of the quantity of water, including additional water for the environment. It must address these issues of salinity and water quality. It should also address this issue of can we use the water that we have more efficiently to get better results. And it must contain a review or review processes so that we can learn as we go to make the thing better as it goes forward. I think I should stop there. There are more slides describing the plan in detail, which you can download as you go. We'll whip through to there.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Tony. I would now like to invite the Premier, the Honourable Jay Weatherill, to the microphone.
Thank you, Chris, and to esteemed South Australian conservationist Barbara Hardy, my parliamentary colleagues, fellow speakers here. Could I also acknowledge that we gather today on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, and can I also acknowledge the Narrangeri people and the other First Peoples for whom the river and the Lower Lakes are an essential part of them. And obviously this debate's a critical one for them. I also would like to particularly thank Elizabeth Ho, for the opportunity to participate in this forum. I don't think this could be a more important issue. I'd like to thank the Hawke Centre for the opportunity of bringing us together to grapple with it. I don't think there's an element of South Australian society that isn't touched by the river and this region around the river. And forums like this are crucial if we're to form a South Australian position on this. And that, I think, is a critical objective. There might be differences of perspective, but we know that the best conceivable result will be achieved by a united position in South Australia. I'd like to begin by summarising where the South Australian Government stands on the issue and explain why. Our simple proposition is this, though. We want a healthy river based on science. That means putting sufficient water back into the river to ensure that it's healthy, and we believe that the return of that water should come from the upstream states. And we say that for a number of key reasons. There's some critical facts in this debate which I think really allow one to understand what the solution has to be. The first is that 93% of the waters of the River Murray are taken by the upstream states. 7% are taken by South Australia. 1% of that goes to metropolitan Adelaide. The other critical fact is that in South Australia, pegged what it took out of the River Murray in 1969. So we haven't taken a drop more since 1969. And the upstream states have been over-allocating the resources of the river and have taken out an additional 5,000 gigalitres over that period. So in the last 40 years, while we've been living and respecting, living within our means, respecting the river, the upstream states have been over-allocating the resources of the river. Now, I think if you accept those propositions, it's pretty simple to see what the nature of the problem is. That is, more water needs to be put back in the river and where it should come from. And that's the proposition that we have been acting on. There was some interesting remarks made about the historical beginnings of the discussion around federation of our river. Much of the debates were devoted, in fact, to the river. I think about a third fully of the constitutional debates for the formation of federation focused on the River Murray. So it was front and centre in the minds of the New South Wales and Victorian delegates and the South Australian delegates that this river was absolutely crucial. And we have continued to be advocating this point. We were at the forefront of Section 100 of the Constitution. We've continued to advocate for the river. We've been at the forefront of every major initiative to protect this river. We put the Murray-Darling Basin on the national agenda in 2003, and later that year, the Living Murray Scheme was agreed, returning 500 gigalitres to the basin. We were the first state to achieve our target within that modest contribution to the health of the river. But that's as far as we could take the other states at that time. Then we fought hard for the creation of the present national authority because long experience told us that the system that was in place, the Murray-Darling Basin Commission, was broken. It essentially meant that any one state could veto it and the pace of change was glacial and we could see what we were left with, a degraded river. So it was a great achievement to get the Water Act 2007, the creation of the Murray-Darling Basin Authority. And when the new authority was set up, we obviously are seeking now to get a plan which will ensure that an independent authority doing its work on the basis of science to give what the river needs to be healthy and then ensuring what is left is equitably divided amongst the other users. That's the plan we signed up for, and that is the promise of the Murray-Darling Basin Authority, and that's the plan that we've got to make sure is delivered. And we owe it to ourselves and to future South Australians, and indeed future Australians, because this is a great national river, that we achieve this objective. And we shouldn't just accept any old plan. Some people have been critical of me and our government for pressing firmly as we are for improvements to the plan. One group of critics say that we should be prepared to accept what's on offer because it's better than what was there previously. Other critics worry about uncertainty. They want certainty, and I think that that's a reasonable request. But I want to deal with these criticisms. First, pressing our case hard will not threaten the development of a plan. This is absolutely clear. It won't force a stalemate, and we will not see the return of the present inadequate arrangements. And the reason I can say that with confidence is the Water Act requires the creation of a plan. If they create an inadequate plan and it's struck down, they'll have to do it again. That's what the Water Act says. It's absolutely clear. So don't accept this nonsense that it's this plan or no plan. That is not the equation that we're faced with. We should not accept a poor compromise. It's true that the authority's proposed return of 2,750 gigalitres will be an improvement, but on our scientific evidence, that's not enough. And from the CSIRO, the Commonwealth's own scientific evidence, it's not enough. So why should we settle for it? Our preliminary advice is that if we settle for what we have at the moment in terms of the draft plan, we'd still be exposed to high levels of risk to the health of the river and to its ecology. And you only need to look at what happened in the Millennium Drought. We've just seen that outlined behind us. Without stronger returns of water to the system, we will, without the necessary flushing effect for the long-term health of the river, we'll be faced with these continual environmental issues, which will not only be damaging to the environment, but also damaging to the economies of our river towns and their neighbouring region, and completely destroying the sense of connection that our First Peoples have with this river. People's futures will still be at risk and certainly will not be delivered with an inadequate plan. There will still be continual demands for improvements in the face of a dying river. So there is no certainty in signing up for an inadequate plan. So the risks of the draft plan that underlie our decision to have our scientists examine the plan in relation to the science have led us to go to the Goethe Institute to review that work. So we're doing our own work, we're getting the best scientists that we can gather to review that work. And my view is that it's incumbent on those who say that 2,750 gigalitres is enough to explain why they will put up with the risks that have been identified by our present scientists. Our view is that if we wanted to be taken seriously in arguing what the plan ought to provide, then we ought to ensure that that work is based on the best possible science, and that's why we've gone to the Goethe Institute. The second point that I want to respond to is the critics make about the plan is that somehow this will lead to some uncertainty if we insist on a better deal. Well, my first point is there is no certainty in a bad deal. What we know is that our irrigators need to see what they will get in the future if they're to make the business plans to ensure that their businesses are prosperous and our regional communities are prosperous. Accepting a second-rate plan will not provide them with that certainty. And indeed, there's a more fundamental point. An unhealthy river is not one that can be a productive river. And so here we have an incredibly important and strong connection between our irrigators and our environmentalists. And indeed, I would say that our irrigators are great environmentalists. Not only do they do their own environmental work, they have accepted a lower take from this river. They've made the efficiencies, often using their own money, together with state government money, to actually make the efficiencies to make them the most efficient irrigators in the system. Now, the reason they've done that is they've respected and understood the natural limits of this river. And that's why they've consistently been strong advocates for the health of this river. We say that the burden of adjustment should fall fairly. If there is to be adjustments and more water goes back in the river, South Australia has showed restraint and foresight for decades. And so the burden of adjustment should not fall on South Australians or South Australian irrigators. As I said, they've spent their own energy, their own money, they have accepted a lower level of economic growth than would otherwise be the case. The 5,000 extra gigalitres that was taken by the upstream states while we stood still amounts to more than 30 years' worth of our current annual draw for Adelaide's water. The river needs more water, and we should look to the extra 5,000 gigalitres that have been taken out of the river by the upstream states when they knew the resource was under threat. It was known that this river was in need of extra water when they continued to over-allocate. Ladies and gentlemen, my plea to you is this: don't settle for second best. Join me in the pursuit of justice not only for this river, but for South Australia and for Australia, because this is a national river. And if we speak with one voice, we will achieve a healthy river, we'll achieve prosperous river communities, and we'll protect the sacred connection that our Aboriginal communities have with this beautiful natural river. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Premier. I would now like to invite the Deputy Leader of the Opposition, the Honourable Mr. Mitch Williams, to the microphone.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for having me here to speak with you this evening. This is one of the most important debates in the history of this state, and it will have a large bearing on the future of this state. Do we get on board, recognising that there is an offer on the table which is superior to any offer that we've had in the last 120 plus years? An offer which we'll see a vastly improved river system as it flows through our state and greater security for both our irrigators and our river communities? Or should we reject the offer saying that we want more, in the knowledge that that may risk us ending up with even less? Let me leave you in no doubt. The Water Act is a creature of the Federal Parliament and can be changed by that Parliament at any time. I need to emphasise that the final outcome, though informed by science, will be constructed by the art of politics. There will be winners and losers, there will be subjective decision making, and there will be compromise. Denial of the reality that politics will play a large part in developing the final plan is not only delusional, but may well lead to a disastrous outcome for this state. As Minister Burke told the Redmark audience last Friday, at a point later this year, he will take ownership of the draft plan, it will become his plan, and he will present it to the Federal Parliament. In case you miss my point, he is a politician, and he's not from South Australia. This is the stated objective of the Murray-Darling Basin Authority. It gives us an insight into the enormity of the task and alerts us to the various competing aspirations. The bottom line is, how confident can we be that the current draft will satisfy the objective, and furthermore, how might it be improved? Does the proposal to allocate 2,750 gigalitres for environmental uses, having recovered this water from river operating and irrigation efficiencies and from consumptive use, strike the right balance between those competing interests? When questioning the downward revision of the quantum of environmental water requirements, I've been told that the latest modelling has taken into account the fact that at least a portion of an environmental flow can achieve outcomes at more than one site within the system. For example, a high flow event designed to flood the Chowwilla floodplain will see much of that water re-enter the river downstream and flow on through the river system, contributing to, say, a desired flow event in the lower lakes. It has been suggested to me that the 2,750 gigalitre flow proposed in the current draft plan, accounting for this, will deliver the same outcome as proposed by about 3,500 gigalitres in the modelling used when preparing the earlier guide. The draft plan also acknowledges that it is not physically possible to deliver optimum flow levels at some sites without creating unintentional flooding at other locations. And the schematic shows some of those physical restrictions. This flooding will cause damage and loss to both private and public assets. This is an unacceptable outcome for the plan. It is one thing for such flooding to occur as a result of a natural occurrence, but quite another to impose such losses via a managed flow event. Thus, we have all the fuss in Queensland over the management of the Wivenhoe Dam and the resulting flooding caused by that management. There is also a perverse outcome of the regime which the MDBA plan proposes. To date, the management of the river system has been predicated on the desire to conserve water, that is, to capture and maintain high levels of water in storage. The proposed regime will instead regularly attempt to regularly mimic natural or pre-development flows. This will be achieved via regular releases from storages, with a consequential expanded capacity to capture runoff from irregular high rainfall events. The simple outcome is that under the proposed regime, we may never or rarely experience those intermittent high flow events. They will be difficult, if not impossible, to generate as managed events, as illustrated by the schematic, and the regime will create the capacity in our upstream storages to mitigate against them from occurring naturally. There are three opportunities to gain water, the water necessary to provide for the environmental flows. In South Australia, we have a proud history of developing best practice water use. We've converted all of our irrigation districts to pipe delivery from river to farm gate. And on farm, we predominantly use drip irrigation and or under canopy sprinklers to maximise the amount of water which is diverted from the river system, which actually gets to the crop being watered. The first opportunity to recover water should be to assist other irrigators throughout the system to get to that level of water use efficiency achieved by irrigators here in South Australia. We in the opposition argue that irrigators in this state should not be called upon to give up any more productive capacity until this level of efficiency is achieved right across the basin. The second source of water is from operational savings, as the river is now a series of weir pools, as demonstrated earlier, particularly in South Australia, as opposed to its natural state as a free-flowing system. Many backwaters and wetlands, which naturally were ephemeral, are now permanently inundated. This is both environmentally detrimental and causes much greater evaporation than under the pre-development case. Additional opportunities to manage flows in and out of wetlands must be taken up. When these opportunities are exhausted, buyback might be needed to meet the plan's requirements. If this is necessary, it should be done in a managed and strategic way to maximise water use efficiency, unlike what we've seen to date. This is the Loxton Irrigation District in South Australia. The blue patches represent blocks from which the water has been sold under the so-called willing seller regime. Across the basin, we now have irrigation districts left in this state with abandoned blocks, but the ongoing requirement to continue to supply all pipes and or channels, leaving a costly and inefficient burden for remaining irrigators. Another question that I've posed is about the export of salt, a very important question to South Australia. This is a typical weir pool where we have fresh water on the top, heavier saline water sinking to the bottom of the weir pool. Currently, the locks operate with an over-the-top flow regime. I've posed the question, what would happen if we reconfigure the locks to allow water to flow through the bottom? I don't know the answer to this, but what I do know that such a scheme has not been modelled. I would argue that it should be modelled, and it may inform us how to do more with less. The Lower Lakes and Coorong are in my electorate, and a number of points I wish to raise about this. In the Narrows, that area between the two lakes, has been severely intervened with by man. We currently see that the flow regime through there has been compromised by material that has been left in there, principally, or more recently, by the bund that was put in at the height of the drought. That must be removed. We must dredge those Narrows, not only to improve the state of water in the Lake Albert, but also to demonstrate very clearly to our cousins upstream that we are serious about the river here in South Australia. The Coorong, the two basins, the southern basin and the northern basin here, the southern basin has become hypersaline. This slide shows the connection between the two basins, and you can see that the flow path is restricted here at Panka Point and Hacks Point, and there's a very small flow path between the two basins. I've argued for a long time that the drainage system that has been developed in the southeast of the state, particularly in the southern part here, has shifted a lot of water which used to flow northwards and end up in the Coorong. This is what George Goyder said in the 1860s of the southeast before drainage of that region of the state. We could return a lot of that water into the Coorong, and that would be added to South Australia's contribution to the changes. Ladies and gentlemen, I would suggest that South Australia would be well served by taking on board the offer that's on the table, informing it further with our submissions along the lines of some of the things that I've pointed out here, and not fall into the trap of aiding and abetting communities upstream who would like to see this plan fail. Speaking to irrigators in other states, they believe that if they can destroy this plan, the next one that's developed, if anyone is developed, will be better for them and worse for us. The plan on balance, I believe, offers us more than I've said, as I've said, that we've had in the last 120 plus years. It is worth us going with this and putting forward submissions, particularly along the lines that I've illustrated here, and I'm sure there are other ideas that will come forward from the South Australian community. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Well, now we're having an opportunity to hear from our stakeholders, and our first stakeholder is Professor Di Bell, representing the Lower Murray.
Good evening, and I've brought my stakes with me. Here they are. All right. A change in pace. I am a stakeholder, and I have a stakeholder perspective. Learning from the past, planning for the future, we're in this together. The proposition that I want to put to you, life returning to the Murray Mouth, is if we can get a plan for South Australia that's right, we've got a plan for Australia. That can be the test case. If it's right for South Australia, it's going to work for all of Australia. Why? This is just to remind us, this is what the Mouth has looked like over the time that we've been documenting it, photographing it. The closure, the silting, the Goulwood Channel in 2009, why do these things matter? What's at stake here? It was open for millennia, closed first time in 1981, was dredged between 2002 and 2012, floods in 2011. Where's the plan for those floods? We've got 2 million tonnes of salt coming down the river. So my stake in the Murray Mouth takes in the Murray Mouth. I'm going to hand that stake to you, sir. And with it would go the Coorong and the lakes, Lake Albert, Lake Alexandrina, and with it would go all the communities that rely on that water. So that would be local communities, Indigenous communities, young, old, immigrant, settled, all those people, all those communities. There we are. They've all got a stake in that mouth being open, getting that 2 million tonnes of salt out. Now, I like to think about visually about this quantity and quality of water. So I started thinking about how much salt is 2 million tonnes of salt. Now that's the MCG, an iconic site. What happens when I get my salt ladle and start putting salt into it? This is what I find out. The towers are 75 metres high. 2 million tonnes of salt, under my calculations, take me up to about 62 metres of salt. That's how much salt has to go out the mouth every year. Unless we have a plan that does that, we don't have a plan for the basin, we don't have a plan for South Australia. How much silt? Mitch already talked about Lake Albert. If we've got that silting up, it's not much good for the people that are growing things. No good if you can't get to your allocation. Even if you've got one, it's no good for the people growing things. So here's for the dairy farmers and the fruit growers and all the other wine growers. That's that stake for them. Alrighty. Now, I also have a stake in science because I am a social scientist and I care very much about science. It's not just another voice. It's not an optional extra. It's built into the plan. And it's good to remind us of this all the time, that the plan requires us to act on the basis of the best available scientific knowledge and socioeconomic analysis. So can we do this? Can we get together a plan? Yes, I think we can. We know the history of the mismanagement. We know what it's needed to succeed. We have a Water Act that was passed because we understood that the river was in crisis. And we have a budget of $10 billion, $9 billion of what's left. So why are we stalled with a plan that pleases no one? I think we haven't yet figured out how to tell the story for all these stakeholders. And into here I'm putting tourism, recreational fishermen, the future generations, South Australians, and my last stakeholder, of course, is the Australian nation. And I think that's the one we don't listen to. Now, we generally get asked, how do we balance these? We're always talking about balance. Well, actually, we don't need to balance them. We need to bind them together, because together, if we all stand together, we're all stakeholders in this, all Australians, so I'm going to bind this together with duct tape, because no good thing is done without duct tape, right? So I'm binding it together with science, and helping me here, with science, which is built into the plan, with the Act that tells us what our target should be, and with $10 billion of taxpayer money for the Australian nation. Right. Because I'm a go-to girl. Right. And because our Premier is the person who has to put this into policy,
Thank you very much for that, Di. I now ask Mr. Ben Haslett, representing the irrigators, to come to the microphone.
Good evening. Thank you for the opportunity to talk. Well, I don't want to just talk about industry that has put $1.5 billion per annum value added into our state and nation before. I don't want to just talk about areas of wetland and river that up until recently hadn't had a drink for 18 years. And I don't just want to talk about a state that's been responsible and managed its water resource well and frugally for a long time. I want to talk about them all together. I want to talk about the balance that we need between all of those things. SA River Communities thinks we do need a plan, but we think we need a fair, balanced plan that is have involvement from everybody, all the stakeholders, not just one particular group, to find the end result that we need. Now, as farmers and food producers, we're very aware of how important it is to have a healthy river. We live on it, we play on it, we absolutely rely on it for our life and for our future. It always strikes me as interesting when people sort of paint us as environmental vandals. And to me, all that shows is those people have no real understanding of modern agriculture in this state and in Australia, because nothing could be further from the truth. We know that all of our farms tend to be multi-generational. We know that if we ruin the land and the assets that relate to that, we have no future. So it always amuses me that people think that farmers and environmentalists are totally different things. Our farm, our family farm, abuts a Ramsar site, a wetland of international significance. And another interesting feature about that is in the last 20-something years, the only practical work, on the groundwork, that's been done to facilitate the billabongs, the flow of fresh water into those wetlands, has been done by farmers, the people who live next door, the people who've made sure that the billabongs are connected, the people who've made sure that we've had flow into those systems. I'm not saying we're the saints of the world. What I am saying is that we're not different from the environmental groups. Effectively, we know more than most the high value on having a healthy river. Now, our farmers and food producers are struggling from a crisis of confidence right now. It's not just because of the high Australian dollar. It's not due to the high input costs we have and ability to compete. It's due to government policy. And that government policy that we're concerned about is around water. And the reason we're concerned about that is because it's the primary input for everything we do. It's like electricity for the city. Just think about it. We had an 18% allocation not so long ago. How well would the city run on 18% of power? How well would it run not knowing what its power level is going to be next year? Every time a farmer plants a tree, it's a 25-year bet. If they don't know what's going to happen, they stop taking that 25-year bet. When they stop taking that 25-year bet, what happens to our food production? What happens to our rural communities? Well, it's pretty clear. So we've heard a couple of the other speakers mention South Australia's past history. And I guess we always look with intrigue as water users at the diversions over the last 40 years. And we note how careful we were 40 years ago to cap what we used. We also note the extra water being used, 3,000 to 5,000 gigalitres of the number over those ensuing 40 years. And many of the people who live in our community say, yeah, we're happy to be part of the solution to the extent we're part of the problem. And then they hold up a zero because they haven't taken any more. Now, the reality is we're already part of the physical solution, the farmers. Each of the areas, the in-valley, the valleys in the system, have got a target. South Australia's is 101 gigalitres. We've found roughly 80 gigalitres of that so far. Where do you think the waters come from? That slide that Mitch put up there, that shows you where the waters come from. So from the people who've invested heavily with state government help, with their own private resources, to be world's best irrigators, they've already contributed. And they're saying enough. So as far as they're concerned, in this state, we shouldn't have to give up more. Now I'm going to have to really speed up. What I'd ask you then, what do you guys want? Because a lot of this comes back to you. In the country, unfortunately, we don't have too much political power. What it comes down to is, what do you as residents want? What are you willing to talk about your electors' members to? Say, do we want a healthy river system? Do we want fresh, safe food to eat? So when we grab a glass of orange juice, it hasn't got some sort of fungicide in it that's not allowed in Australia. Or do we want both? And SA River communities to say to you that we can have both, but we need a balance. And there's a range of things we need to do to achieve that balance. Firstly, we think we need to do a system audit. Let's find out where we can save the water before pulling it out of world best practice production. That would make sense to us. Why pull it out first and then go, shoot, we've grabbed it from the wrong place? I think we've talked about 101 gigalitres. We said, let's cap South Australia's contribution. We agree with the Premier. We shouldn't be giving back any more. So we want to cap that. We'd really like our state government to also look outside the box, so that if we do cap it, that maybe this state government can look at a water bank for ways that we can keep that critical water inside our system so our infrastructure is still good. And in fact, you as the taxpayer is not paying for the same stuff we've already got here and built somewhere else when we've got state-of-the-art infrastructure here. And lastly, for a balanced and fair plan, everyone needs to play their part, and that's everybody who's reliant on that water in the Murray-Darling Basin system. So if we want to share in that gain for that system, we all need to share in the pain, not one specific group. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Ben. Our final speaker is Associate Professor Daryl Regney, who will present us with a Narrangeri perspective.
Thank you. I want to begin my presentation with the appropriate Aboriginal cultural protocol, and I want to acknowledge the Kaurna Aboriginal Nation as the original inhabitants of the lands and waters of the City of Adelaide. I also want to acknowledge my fellow panellists and thank all those who have attended today. Today could be characterised as a historic moment for Aboriginal people. Historic in the sense that it's one of those rare moments, pardon the pun, Di, I didn't want to fall into your stake exhibition there, rare moments where Aboriginal people are being asked by government for their position on a particular issue as the state attempts to develop a united response to that issue. This doesn't happen very often. Today I represent the Ngarrindjeri Regional Authority, the Ngarrindjeri Nation, and the chair of that regional authority, Uncle Tom Trevorrow. The Ngarrindjeri people are the descendants of the original Indigenous inhabitants of the lands and waters of the River Murray, Lower Lakes and Coorong, and adjacent areas. Ngarrindjeri continue to assert control over these lands and waters by the continuation of the practice of our culture upon these traditional lands in pursuit of economic, social and cultural development. Ngarrindjeri consider that all things are connected, including the land, water and sky. Ngarrindjeri are part of the water. It is life, gives life and is living. The cultural and spiritual relevance of the four Ngarrindjeri of water as a source of life and as part of the living body is that it flows within, around and through Ngarrindjeri country. The exercise of Ngarrindjeri cultural rights and the fulfilment of Ngarrindjeri responsibility to country include being interconnected with parts of the living water. The failure of water to flow into Ngarrindjeri country impacts upon our exercise of our rights and our fulfilment of our responsibilities as custodians of the land, water and sky. In fact, to break connection between person and place through a lack of water is to violate Ngarrindjeri culture. The objective in undertaking activities upon Ngarrindjeri country should be to not cause violence to Ngarrindjeri culture, and so the plan needs to take consideration of that from a Ngarrindjeri perspective. Ngarrindjeri consider they have a first right, a right attached to the exercise of our cultural rights, interests and responsibilities that precedes all other rights, including but not limited to the responsibility of the MDBA and other bodies to allocate water to users. The rights and interests of the Ngarrindjeri require that water flows into their country from upriver. This is a right a priori to all others, and consideration of water allocations should proceed without interference or diminishment of that right. Notwithstanding the above right, Ngarrindjeri consider that the management of water by the MDBA and other non-Indigenous bodies can include uses which result in allocation and priority being given to specific places which support the cultural spaces, such as wetlands where birds, fish, plants, animals live and breed, and for the allocation of use of water by Ngarrindjeri people and others for the purpose of other activity. Section 21 of the Water Act 2007 says that the authority and the minister must have regard to Indigenous issues. Section 22(1) of the Act says that mandatory content of the Basin Plan include the use to which the basin water resources are put, including Indigenous people. Section 22(3) of the Act says that requirements must include circumstances relating to tradable water rights. Schedule 4, Clause 4, states that restrictions on extractions, diversions and use of water resulting from trade can only be used to manage features of major Indigenous, cultural heritage or spiritual significance. As I said, Ngarrindjeri are the traditional owners of a registered site of this area. And there's a registered site there. It's called a Meeting of the Waters site. This Aboriginal site is registered under the Aboriginal Heritage Act, South Australia. It includes the Goolwa Channel, the Murray Mouth and parts of Currency Creek and Finniss River. The natural state of this area requires an adequate freshwater flow from upriver to flush out the Murray Mouth and ensure that Ngarrindjeri are able to continue to exercise their cultural rights in this area. The state of South Australia, in its capacity as a basin state, should ensure that registered Aboriginal sites, other recorded Aboriginal sites, and other Aboriginal sites under the Act, being features of major Indigenous cultural heritage or spiritual significance, apply as a restriction on extraction under the water trading rules. In effect, this means that the end of system flow should occur to the Murray Mouth to protect the Meeting of the Waters Aboriginal site. The proposed basin plan does not comply with the mandatory requirements in section 21 of the Act, 22 of the Act, which says that mandatory content of the basin plan include the use of which the river basin water resources are put, including Indigenous people. The use of water is not adequately referred to in part 14 of the basin plan. It's actually schedule 1 in the plan English summary. It defers the issue to further consultation and consideration under water resource plan. It does not comply with the mandatory requirement to have regard to Indigenous issues as required by section 21 of the Act. It does not have regard to the prior right of Indigenous peoples as referred to in the opening part of this presentation. It refers only to use of water by Indigenous people, but only where these align with or enhance environmental outcomes, and our interests extend beyond our environmental outcomes. The MDBA does recognise an impact to Indigenous peoples of the Basin Plan could be that there is not sufficient water to maintain Indigenous cultures. Whilst recognising the risk, the plan does not respond to it. Arguably, if this basin plan were accepted by the minister, it would be open to the claim that it was inconsistent with the requirements of the Racial Discrimination Act 1975. So in conclusion, I think I want to make this point in relation to Ngarrindjeri's position on the basin plan, that Ngarrindjeri desire to establish more effective ways of working in partnership to ensure cultural values and Ngarrindjeri aspirations are respectfully, equitably, and appropriately integrated into water management planning and subsequent implementation. Following the agreement-making process that the Ngarrindjeri have engaged with a variety of other stakeholders in both land and water management, this is our preferred strategy because it is a strategy that we hope leads to a stronger, more respectful engagement with the Government of South Australia and the Murray-Darling Basin Authority. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Darryl. And that concludes the formal part of the presentation, but we now have 15 minutes, or just under 20 minutes, actually, to have some questions and have some questions directed to the panel. To stimulate the discussion, what I've done is exert a chairman's prerogative to ask the first question. And the question to each of our panel members, all seven of our panel members, is to provide one dot point on what must be included in the plan and what must not be allowed to happen. So perhaps we could start with Susan.
Initially it was what I think should be in the Basin Plan, which is an awareness of the historical and environmental context, not only that long background that I described, which includes models for successful action as well as for unsuccessful action, but also an awareness of the cultural heritage of the river. And we've just heard about the need for an integrating the human and the environmental uses. Do you want the not now?
Yes, the not now, thank you. Yep.
Well, the not is sort of a double negative, really. I would not want to see an overemphasis on, in particular, the northern basin. There seems to me a great deal of emphasis on the Northern Basin use of the water. The point is that if that has been made tonight is that if unless we have water coming right through to the bottom end of the river, the whole system is not healthy.
Thank you, Susan. Tony.
Thank you, Chris. I think in a nutshell, at least, one of the main things I think driving it, it's also being hinted at by others here as well, is that what I think is really needed in that plan is a good indication of what ecological system do we want in the river and how much water is actually necessary to obtain that, rather than the way the plan is at the moment. This is the amount of water we've got and this is what we can do with that water.
What must not happen?
And what must not happen, this is getting into these horrible dark negatives, what must not happen is they must not omit climate change in the plan as they have at the moment.
Thank you, Tony. Premier.
Well, healthy river based on science and no further burden of adjustment on South Australia.
Fantastic. Mitch.
Thank you, Chris. Sorry about that, ladies and gentlemen. I think the Basin Plan should have an equitable acknowledgement of the contribution that irrigators, certainly in South Australia, have made over a long period of time. And the plan should be equitable in its treatment of irrigation communities throughout the length of the system. What should not be in the plan, I think we have been captured somewhat by numbers, and the plan keeps talking about the number of, or expressing in numbers, the amount of water that should be available for the environmental flows. I think we should be concentrating more on outcomes than raw numbers. And as was expressed in Renmark last week, one of the worst outcomes we would have is if we reserved a volume of water for environmental flows that physically could not be used.
Thank you.
I want to see a plan that includes compliance with the key outcomes of the Water Act, as supported by peer-reviewed science. What must not happen? I think it would be a disaster if we were to proceed with a plan that locks in failure in the future.
Thank you, Matt.
Ben. I think we'd like to see South Australia's water licences to retain the same level of security after the plan as they had before it. And on a not, don't remove water from efficient food production before examining all savings that can be made via infrastructure or running of the river or other means, such that we don't overshoot the mark.
Thank you, Darryl. Darryl? Thank you, Ben. Darryl.
What should be in the plan? I think proper acknowledgement of the position of Aboriginal people in terms of water that allows for the MDBA to properly take account of those interests.
Can you shorten that a little, please?
A proper understanding and acknowledgement and a legitimate effort to include Indigenous interests.
And what shouldn't?
Well, the what shouldn't is a really hard one for us. It's rather circular in the sense that it reminds me of going to dinner and looking in at a restaurant and seeing people at a table eating and making choices about what plates will be put on the table and what takes off when we're actually standing outside the restaurant. I don't have a position on what should be taken out. I think actually, because we're not at the table, the other interests, other parties are fighting that out.
Thank you very much for that. Can I ask you to come to the microphone or to call for a microphone that's there? If you have a question, please, time's limited, so keep your questions very brief. And if you wish to direct them to a particular individual, that's great too.
With regard to the basing the plan on science, I want to know what the significance of the basin is. I mean, the alluvial basin, groundwater. How significant is that considering science?
The groundwater may be significant. It has a lot to do with whether or not the groundwater systems are connected to the river, and there are significant uncertainties at this stage as to which groundwater systems are connected, which are not connected. So in the answer, a short question, is groundwater significant? Yes. Is it particularly significant in the areas being considered in the basin at the moment? Unknown.
G'day, I'm Michael Rowling from Radio Adelaide. I would just like to ask, there's been a lot of talk of modelling and talking about flows and litres and things like that, but how much costing has been done for the necessary infrastructure to bring the other states up to the same standards that we're seeing from irrigators in South Australia implement over the last 40 years?
Thank you for that. That's a powerful question. Anyone like to take that?
Look, I don't know what the answer is. What I do know is that the Commonwealth has set aside $10 billion for essentially what they call bridging the gap, that is buying back or putting infrastructure works in that will take you from where we are now to where the plan takes us. And the for obvious reasons, most of the infrastructure works that give you the most water tend to be in the upstream states. But that creates an inequity because the quite efficient users downstream here in South Australia are being almost leapfrogged, if you like, by that investment upstream. So the simple answer is most of the water is capable of being got put back in through investments upstream, but that does a further injustice to our irrigators here in South Australia. But I'm not sure whether they've... I know that the other states have put in lots of bids for additional infrastructure works. I don't know whether there's a list somewhere where all of those are calculated.
Thank you for that.
Yes, Bob O'Brien from Percat Water. Percat owns and trades water licences. Question to the Premier about potential High Court challenges, and there's been a lot of press about that. I'm just wondering comments about how likely would any success of a High Court challenge be, bearing in mind the competing interests of the Water Act and the aspects of the Constitution?
Well, we won't pursue a High Court challenge unless it's got reasonable prospects of success. But what I've done is ask for that legal advice, and the advice that we've received is that it's a fundamental principle of federation that all states are equal. That when the states combined together, they did so with an implication that one state or group of states couldn't combine to destroy or damage the interests of another state. And they believe that principle applies to interboundary rivers, largely for the reasons that were outlined by Mr. Daniels in the beginning about the history of federation and the way in which the Commonwealth essentially left that issue to the states. And essentially, the principle goes that you can't damage or deplete an interboundary river such that it damages the interests of a downstream state, which seems like a pretty common sense principle and flows from the fact that we didn't come together as inferior partners, we came together as a group of equals. Now, whether that will succeed or not and what flows from that, we're still doing work on. Our preference is to get an improvement in the plan, but I believe in going into negotiations and discussions with both, you know, a carrot and a stick, and that's what I'm carrying into the discussions.
Thank you. This gentleman, and then this gentleman, and then Barbara.
Yeah, Trevor Harden, Lower Lakes resident. Look, I think it's important to separate out severe drought issues from the over-allocation issues, or it gets confused. For example, in extreme drought, when there's no water in the system to be managed, one water management plan is no more useful than any other plan. So my question is, if a 4,000 gigalitre plan, or even a 7,600 gigalitre plan, was in place 10 years ago, how could it have prevented the Lower Lakes from drying out in 2009?
An excellent question. Anyone want to...
Well,
Mitch?
I'll tell you. Yeah, look, the modelling that's been done by the MDBA shows that in the impact of that drought would be significantly less under the proposed plan, because the 2,750 gigalitres would remain in storage, specifically earmarked for the environment. So during that drought period where we saw very little flows, very small flows in the river, and most of those flows being taken up by consumptive use, there would be that amount of water in storage specifically for the maintenance of river flows. And the modelling shows that the lakes, the levels in the lakes would have been much better than what we achieved over the last 10-year period during the millennium drought.
And to add to that, if I may, although the we were in extreme drought, there was still water for sale on the market.
Mm. That's right.
Okay. Thank you for that, Mr. Chairman.
I'd like to add to the list of must-be-included and that is that the plan must include enough water to flush out the 2 million tonnes of salt out to sea. I think we should recognise that 70% of that salt comes from New South Wales and Victoria, only 30% from South Australia. I've looked at the modelling, which underpins that figure of 2750 gigalitres, and at present there are no targets for salinity for Lake Alexandrina or Lake Albert. And what that really means is there's no way of actually telling whether you've actually flushed the salt out to sea. So my specific recommendation would be at section 8.18 of the basin plan, there'd be a target for Lake Alex and a target for Lake Albert.
Thank you. I guess that wasn't a question. Perhaps Barbara first?
It was
Barbara's the patron of my
Peter,
institute.
It was my goal in saying that all key outcomes should be met to cast the net as broadly as possible to include the mouth.
Thank you. My question is about knowledge of not only the community but of young people. How much knowledge of this Murray-Darling Basin plan, the implications of it, ideas for it, is in our schools, in the curriculum? I'd be very keen to know how much of all this sort of important issue, the Murray-Darling Basin itself, is within our school system as part of the curriculum.
I guess we have the ex-education minister here.
Yeah, I mean, it would be tempting for me to rush this into all of the public schools in the state, but I think I know what would happen if, from my political opponents, that's how I was politicising the school system. But look, I think in a general sense, educating our young people about our precious environmental assets is crucial. I know that there's been some wonderful work done by school children in all around the state. Indeed, some of them have participated in the recovery of some of the fish that were under some pressure, the native fish that were taken out and recovered when the lakes were in those very low flow conditions, and have participated in programs to restore them. So we have been engaging with our school children about these issues. I mean, these should be basic educational resources that are provided in our education system. I suppose the national curriculum gives us an opportunity to build this into our science curriculum. I would have thought the River Murray is an ideal opportunity to discuss these issues, but I don't know what's in the science curriculum in relation to the river, but I can check on that for you.
I can certainly say through the NRM.
Can I just make a comment? And I don't want to offend anybody in the room, but Di and I were chatting earlier before we actually started, and we did note that the demographic in the room didn't include a lot of really young people.
It doesn't mean that the young people aren't interested. I mean, there's a lot of work through the Youth Environment Council and through many schools that involve the NRM boards and through the Science for Schools.
I must add, Chris, we both lamented the fact.
Yeah. But that is a good point, and we do need to keep our young people engaged.
And what we should add is that the children, in fact, are leading the way. And if you go to the Malang School and see what they've done with the rehabilitation project for the turtles there, they started that as an initiative that grew out of that community, and they actually led the way. It took a while for everything else to catch up with them. And that is a really stunning model of how kids will respond to local communities, will get the expertise they need, draw on it statewide, nationally and internationally. And that's really a model, I think, for how to do engaged, community-based science education.
Wayne.
One of the things we've seen in this debate is the huge variability that's associated with this river system and the huge complexity which is associated with trying to manage it. And what I fear is that when we've had this absolute disproportionate focus on a number of gigalitres to be returned to the river, we are indeed getting to the point of locking ourselves into future failure. So my question is, from the panel, what do you think, how are we placed in terms of having, does this plan give us the capacity, the flexibility, the adaptability in the processes that it should encompass to allow us to adapt and manage in this hugely complex and need for a flexible system?
Let's be absolutely clear about this. The Water Act requires us to come up with a number. So this idea of, you know, being fixated on magic numbers, is it being a problem? Well, that's the task. And the truth is that there is a certain amount of water that is going to have an environmental outcome. Now, I think that that doesn't answer the question that you pose, which is a much more sophisticated question about how you run the river, how it's managed, how... So sitting underneath the plan is a whole range of other very sophisticated structures, such as environmental watering plans, the way in which the various states run the river and the rules associated with running the river. And at a more fundamental level, there's a 10-year review, which... Now, at the moment, there is... So once the plan's in place, there's to be a 10-year review that's required by the Act. So, look, I think that's right, but let's not lose sight of the fact that there is a first-order issue to grapple with. How much does this river need to be a healthy river? And I know there are a lot of people that don't want to talk about that because they want to talk about outcomes, but for me, that's a bit of code for essentially not fixing on the number that the river needs.
Ben wanted to comment?
Just like to add a comment to that from our perspective in that... We think we need a starting point no matter what. I think that's a fair point. We're going to have a number. One of the things we're concerned about when we read the plan is that 2015, we hear about adaptive management, 10-year review. Our real concerns is whether or not those reviews have enough teeth, whether or not they're going to be funded and have the right people in charge. It's all very well to have people in charge now say this will happen, but will it? That's one of our concerns. And then whether or not it's politically palatable. If we end up coming up with a number that a range of people agree on, and we find along the way that maybe the models don't do exactly what we thought, which we'd be surprised if they did, because no model's perfect, and we need to go up or down either way, will it be politically palatable, or will the review have strong enough teeth to actually get good actions for the information we find?
I'm Leslie Fisher, and I live down... I'm a farmer. I was an irrigator and dairy farmer. And because I live between the shores of Lake Albert and the Coorong, I've been able to watch the devastation of what's actually happening down there. And it's been happening over a number of years. 30-odd years ago, our community was saying, we've got trouble in Lake Albert with salinity. And they've been trying, they've been doing the same thing over and over again. Lift the level up, drop it, lift it and drop it. It's not working anymore. Lake Albert is dying.
Please come to your question.
Pardon?
Please come to a question.
Okay. I want to know what this state government is going to do for helping Lake Albert recover, because we are in big trouble down there, and we actually as a community have got a plan together, and we would like the government to look at the proposition that we are putting to them. We are the ones that have been living there and living with the problem and have got solutions.
Thank you. Lake Albert.
Well, it's what we're all going to do about getting the plan we need for a healthy river, because Lake Albert is as I think somebody very eloquently described it, the canary in the mine shaft. That's the place that's having one of the greatest levels of environmental, I suppose, pressure applied to it. So that's the answer. More broadly, of course, there was some substantial infrastructure works that were about getting potable water around the lakes, substantial... government contributions to build an alternative supply of water that was able to be to meet the needs of the farming communities. But we do know that there are some people that irrigate directly from those lakes, and there's not a justification for them not to be healthy, and we'll pursue that through the plan.
Perhaps I can speak in relation to a couple of the comments and questions relating to young people. I can say that I recall back in high school, so about 10 years ago, attending an environment camp and finding that young people around me were incredibly well informed and incredibly concerned. And I think perhaps partly the issue for young people is that although I thank all the speakers today, you've been incredibly informative, essentially most of the science, most of the environmental concerns and certainly concerns of the irrigators have been the same for a long period of time. And the frustration probably grows that a solution hasn't already been reached. So I guess my question really is to the environmentalists and to the politicians, to all of you, what makes you so optimistic that we can reach an outcome now, given that perhaps not a lot has changed in the situation?
Because we have a piece of legislation that guides us, that comes out of our historical understanding of what went wrong, because we have an enormous budget to do the restructuring that's needed, and because we have best scientific knowledge that tells us over a long period of time and right now and can be tested and what is needed. So we've got all the things that we need to act on.
I think there is reason for optimism. There has been 100 years of squabbling, but there is a real opportunity now, and that's why we're all here trying to come up with the South Australian position to make sure we get the best possible plan we can get.
Now, I will ask Professor Palawala to bring the proceedings to a close and to hand out some small gifts.
Thanks, Chris. I'll be very brief. I understand the Premier needs to leave. I'm really glad that you did this summary, so I don't actually have to summarise the proceedings. I don't know how you'd summarise a debate of this nature, but I really do want to thank everybody for coming tonight. But I think the Hawke Centre and the Barbara Hardy Institute are very committed to having a public debate, and this is very much the mission of the university, to reach out to the community. And so thank you for coming, and especially thank you to all our speakers, the Premier, the Deputy Leader, and to all the other speakers. So thank you very much.